know about this joy that is offered through Jesus. Father, I pray that today would be the day that they would know, that they would believe, and that they would enter into that joy and that rest and that security that is only offered by you. So, Father, have your way. Holy Spirit, do your work in our midst. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You guys may be seated. Before we jump straight into Philippians chapter 4, let me share something with you that was written by a man by the name of Avery T. Willis Jr. How many of you guys have ever heard of him? No worries. You may have heard what he's written, though, didn't know that he's the one that wrote it. You see, Avery was an African pastor in Zimbabwe. And after his death, they uncovered his writings, some of his writings. And among them was this. And I want to share it with you this morning. He writes this: I am part of the fellowship of the unashamed. I have Holy Spirit power. The die has been cast. I have stepped over the line. The decision has been made. I am a disciple of His. I won't look back, let up, slow down, back away, or be still. My past is redeemed. My present makes sense. My future is secure. I am finished and down with low living, done with low living. Sight walking, small planning, smooth knees, colorless dreams, tamed visions, mundane talking, cheap living, and dwarfed goals. I no longer need prominence, prosperity, position, promotions, plaudits, or popularity. I don't have to be right, first, tops, recognized, praised, regarded, or rewarded. I now live by faith, lean on His presence, walk by patience, lifted by prayer, labor by power. My face is set, my gate is fast, my goal is heaven, my road is narrow, my way is rough, my companions are few, my guide is reliable, my mission is clear. I cannot be bought, compromised, detoured, lured away, turned back, deluded or delayed. I will not flinch in the face of sacrifice, hesitate in the presence of the adversary, negotiate at the table of the enemy, ponder at the pool of popularity, or meander in the maze of mediocrity. I won't give up, shut up, let up, until I have stayed up, stored up, prayed up, paid up, and preached up for the cause of Christ. I am a disciple of Jesus. I must go till He comes, give till I drop, preach till all know, and work till He stops me. And when He comes for His own, He will have no problem recognizing me. My banner is clear. Let's pray so we can dismiss. That's enough, right? It's powerful. And for Avery, these were more than just words, because you know what these words got him? Martyred. Martyred for his faith. This wasn't something that we just put on a poster or on a t-shirt. He meant every single word of this. And as I read these words, I just can't help but think of what a picture of steadfastness and what it looks like in the Christian life. And it's also the perfect illustration of how the Apostle Paul opened up chapter 4 of Philippians, as we just read. You see, in chapter 4, Paul addresses the importance of spiritual stability or steadfastness. He wants to make sure, as he closes off this important epistle to the church at Philippi, that they remain unmovable, that they won't become like waves of the sea driven back and forth by every wind of doctrine. And so he's going to admonish them to be steadfast. We see it there in verse 1. When he says, Therefore, my brothers, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm thus in the Lord, my beloved. The Greek word there is stecho. Stecho. And here's what I need you to understand. This word right here, stand firm, it's two parts in English, one word in Greek, stecho. It is the main verb in verses 1 through 9. It is the main verb in verses 1 through 9. It's an imperative, it's a command with almost a military-like ring to it. That's what he's talking about here. It means to stand in one place, to be immovable or stationary, to persevere. So get the picture here. As soldiers on the front line of a very real spiritual battle, you and I, as believers, are commanded to hold our position even while we are under attack. Even while we are in the midst of trials and uncertainty. When everything in us and everyone around us is screaming, run. Compromise. Change. The Bible is clear that we are to stand firm. Stand firm. It's important that we understand that this is a theme that is literally littered throughout the New Testament, this idea of spiritual stability and perseverance. As a matter of fact, 14 times in the New Testament, we are told to stand fast or to be steadfast or immovable. And so here's the question. If that's the case, what can we draw from this? If 14 times we are told to be steadfast, to stand fast, to be immovable, what should we learn from this? I think it's very important we understand this and that we understand ourselves that as Christians, there are situations, there are trials, there are personal tendencies that make us, hear me clearly, not want to hold our ground, but retreat. There's things that make us want to run and hide, to go away, and even contemplate to quit following Christ. It's important we get this. That's why often throughout the New Testament, we are reminded, we are exhorted, we are commanded to stand firm. To stand firm. I think this is an amazing word for us. I mean, again, the timing of the Holy Spirit and of our Father in heaven is impeccable, is it not? In the midst of where we're at right now. Because many of you know exactly what I'm talking about. Many of you have this temptation. Many of you are just on the verge of saying, I'm done. You're ready to wave the white flag and surrender. You're ready to haul back and retreat. And the message from God to you this morning through His Word is stand firm. Stand firm. Why? Because God is faithful. God is faithful. I want you to see this very quickly. I need you to grasp how important of a concept this is for you and I as Christians. It's important that we get this. Now, again, we see that after Christ ascends into heaven, the gospel's preached, and 3,000 souls come into salvation, come into the faith. The church is birthed. But as you and I know, as we read the early parts of Acts chapter 2 particularly, and on, all the way through verse 8, the early church is made up predominantly of Jewish people. Made up of Jews. What's interesting is that when the first Gentiles begin to come to Christ, the first apostolic message to the Gentile church is, stand fast. See this very clearly in Acts chapter 11. You see, after the Gentile church was founded in Antioch, the Jerusalem church sent Barnabas to them. And here is what is recorded in Acts chapter 11, verse 23. Here's what it says. Acts 11, 23, for those of you guys who are taking notes. The report of the church in Jerusalem. And they sent Barnabas to Antioch. And when he came and saw the grace of God, he was glad. And he exhorted them to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose. That was his message. This is amazing what God has done here. Here's my exhortation to you. Remain faithful. Stay steadfast in the purpose of the Lord. Don't run. Don't cower in fear. Remain steadfast. Remain faithful. As a matter of fact, as we look at the first missionary journey with Paul and Barnabas, it was a huge part of their ministry. As they went around to the churches, as they were strengthening the souls of the disciples, encouraging them to continue in the faith, saying that through many tribulations, we must enter the kingdom of God, Acts chapter 14, verse 22. Right? Stay faithful. Paul was so concerned about the spiritual stability of the churches under his care that he wrote many times on many occasions to this topic. We could look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58. When Paul writes these words to the church at Corinth, "Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain." Highlight that and underline that. See, the enemy wants to tell you that all that's going on here doesn't matter. That no one really cares, that God doesn't see. But notice what Paul says here. He says to remain steadfast, to stand firm, and knowing this, what? Vapor. It will have lasting significance, not only in this life, but more importantly, in the one to come. Some of you are tired. It's been a long row. And there's this temptation to ease up, to let up, to give up. I offer to you the words of Paul. Be steadfast. Be immovable. Be ready to always abound in the work of the Lord, knowing that the Lord, that in the Lord, your labor is not empty. It's not in vain. It has significance. A little later on, next chapter over, 1 Corinthians 16, Paul says this in verse 13. He says, "Be watchful, stand firm in the faith, act like men, be strong. Let all that you do be done in love." Now, we could spend all day just on this verse. Right? But notice, be watchful. We should discern the times that we're living in. We should understand what's going on around us. We should be able to interpret what's happening. Be watchful. That means we have to have our head up looking around. Because the enemy, as Peter says, is like a lion seeking whom he may devour. We've got to be watchful of what's going on. But notice what he says as he continues, "and firm in the faith." Steko. Don't run, don't move. Hold your ground, quite literally. In the faith, hold your ground. Don't run. Stand for what's true, for who is true. Don't move. As he said earlier in chapter 15. Later on in Galatians, in chapter 5, he writes these words, "For freedom Christ has set us free." Amen. Stand firm, therefore. Because that's true, stand firm in your freedom. Right? And we know what Paul's writing to the Galatians about. The church of Galatia was quickly moving from the gospel of grace that was given to them as a gift of faith to a gospel of works earned by their actions. And Paul's going like, what are you doing? Christ sets you free from all of that, from all the performance and all the failure and all of it. That's the idea that he's getting to in chapter 5 as he closes up the letter. He says, "For freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm in that freedom, therefore. Don't move from the freedom that Christ has given you. Don't give it away as if it's nothing. Stand firm. Stand firm in that freedom. Don't go back into slavery." As a matter of fact, that's how he finishes off the verse. He says, For freedom's sake, for freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. Don't go back to that. Do you see what he's saying? In this instance, in this case, when he's talking to the Galatians, he's saying, in this instance, to lose ground is to go back into slavery. That's insane. To give up, to let go, has dire consequences. To release that liberty that only comes through Christ. In the passage dealing with spiritual warfare that I kind of quoted from earlier, Paul three times commands believers to stand firm. In Ephesians chapter 6, beginning in verse 11, notice these words. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. He says, because we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, right? But against principalities, right? Against authorities, against cosmic powers over spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. Look at verse 13. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, stand firm. In the midst of spiritual warfare that we even see going on today, stand firm. Don't capitulate, don't negotiate, don't give up. Stand firm. To the Colossians, he wrote this in chapter 2, verse 5. For though I am absent in body, yet I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the firmness of your faith in Christ. You're seeing a pattern here? You're seeing a pattern. It's all about steadfastness, about stecho. To the Thessalonians, he writes in chapter 3, verse 8, for now we live if you are standing fast in the Lord. And goes on to write in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 15, he says this, so then, brothers, stand firm and hold to the traditions that you were taught by us, either by spoken word or by letter. Don't give up. Now, Paul's not the only one in the New Testament that speaks to this topic and addresses this head on, because it's so important. Again, I kind of referenced this in the beginning of my sermon this morning, where James in chapter 1 talks about us not being waves of the sea that are being tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. We shouldn't be like the unstable men. That we should ask and live our lives in faith in the midst of trials. We should be firm in what we believe and what we profess. As Peter closed off his first epistle, he pleaded with his readers to stand firm in the grace of God. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 12, for those of you that want to look it up later. As he closed off the first epistle of Peter, he says, stand firm in the grace of God. But I want us all to go to 2 Peter chapter 2. Because in his second epistle, and specifically in 2 Peter chapter 2, Peter is addressing the issue of false prophets. And not only false prophets, he's addressing the whole idea of false believers as well. But he's dealing with false prophets and false teachers. And we see this in verse 1 of chapter 2. Notice what he says. But false prophets also arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you. Now notice again, important word, among. They're not going to come from without. It's the same thing that when Paul, as we talked about last week, when he's headed away, he meets with the Ephesian elders and he says, "Man, hey, I want you to be watchful because savage wolves will arise from among you, not sparing the flock." Peter returns to this idea here in his epistle, and he talks about these false prophets and these false teachers who will arise from among you, who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. So that's the context of what Peter's writing. But notice with me for time's sake, we don't have time to go through the whole thing, but look at verse 14 specifically. Speaking about these false teachers and these false prophets, he says this: "They have eyes full of adultery, insatiable for sin. They entice unsteady souls. They have hearts trained in greed, accursed children." Do you see what these false prophets and false teachers do? They entice the unsteady soul. They entice the unsteady soul. Peter warns us about this. And so it's not only important that you as a Christian, that I as a Christian, are steadfast, immovable in our faith, that we don't turn tail and run, that we don't give up ground. But it's important that we as a church remain steadfast, as we follow after the goodness and grace of our Lord Jesus Christ revealed through his word. And I'm thankful, and I say this in all sincerity, in all humbleness, that by the grace of God, we've remained steadfast on the gospel. We haven't run off with the newfangled latest and greatest thing. And by God's grace and by his Spirit, we will hold each other accountable, and we will continue on that for many years to come. It's sad to me to see in this day and age, and again, I'm not saying that we're better than anyone else, because we have our flaws, we've made our mistakes, and we'll continue to make more mistakes, to see so many churches moving from the truth of the gospel for what's certain for what's not in these times. And it's sad to see how so many unstable souls go after these false prophets and these false teachers that are saying all these things, that there's going to be health and wealth and security and safety. And, "Oh man, tell me more. Man, this is going to be my best life ever. This is going to be my best year ever. Please tell me more. Give me more. I'll read your book. I'll buy your book." And they're lies. Don't trade what is true, revealed through the scriptures, for what's not. And here's the thing, I'm not just picking up people outside of our camp. I'm talking about even pastors that I love and respect who have said some things as of late that I would just scratch my head and go, like, why? Right? Because they're caving to the pressure of trying to give people a way for their conscience to be okay with doing certain unbiblical things. God has called me to stand firm as your pastor. God has called you to stand firm as a church. We need to stand firm on what? On Christ, right? Stand firm in Christ Jesus, Paul says in verse 1. Stand firm. He skip to chapter 3 of 2 Peter. Again, Peter brings this point home. I think you're getting the whole idea here, but many of you will resonate with this. 2 Peter chapter 3. Starting in verse 14, it says, "Therefore." When he's talking about the day of the Lord and what's going to happen, he says, "Therefore, beloved, since you are waiting for these," for all that he's talked about in chapter 3, "be diligent to be found by him without spot or blemish and at peace." Be diligent to live a holy life and have your trust in him, no matter what's going on around you. "And count the patience of our Lord as salvation, just as our beloved brother Paul also wrote to you according to the wisdom given him." Now check this out. "As he does in all his letters, when he speaks in them of these matters, there are some things in them that are hard to understand." I'm so thankful Peter wrote that. Aren't you? Because what he's saying is, man, have you read some of Paul's letters? I don't understand half. Have you read Romans? Particularly verse 9? He's going like, man, I just got to trust God on this one. He says, it's hard to understand. But notice what he says, which the ignorant and unstable twist to their own destruction as they do other scripture. You therefore, beloved, knowing this beforehand, take care that you are not carried away with the error of lawlessness, people, and lose your own, what, church? Stability. The Bible says, Paul particularly says this to Timothy, a young pastor. He says that in the last days, men won't endure sound teaching or doctrine, but will heap up for themselves teachers who will tickle their ears. Who will tell, basically, they want people who are going to tell them what, like, tell me what I want to hear, not what they need to hear. And whenever you pursue that kind of teaching, whenever you pursue that type of message, you're moving yourself from the stability that is offered through the person and work of Jesus, through the power of the gospel, to instability. You're following after false teachers whose God is their belly, as Paul said last week, and glory is their shame. It's that serious, church. And there's so many things around us today, right now, 2020, that can threaten our stability. And some of us, if we had to be honest, if you had to be honest, I'm not calling you out, because I'm there too, have fallen prey to this. Your stability in Christ, in the gospel, has been diminished because you've gone after further stability or something comfortable in this or that or the other. And now your life not only lacks stability, but we see the byproduct of stability is, what is this whole book about? What have we been saying the whole book of Philippians is about? When your life lacks stability, guess what your life lacks? There's joy in stability, church. There is joy in stability. Spiritual instability leads to disappointment, doubt, discouragement, lack of joy, and ultimately, listen to me clearly, an ineffective witness for Christ. And that's what our life should be about, right? Everything we do is to give witness to the power, the grace of the gospel of Jesus Christ in our lives. People should look at our lives, scratch their heads and marvel and go, man, tell me about this God that you serve. But instability diminishes our witness. So often I see that unstable people are crushed by their trials instead of perfected in them. Right? Because they bought into this idea that the God they serve would not allow this to happen in their life. But yet James, in that chapter I quoted from you earlier, says, count it all joy, brothers, when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. But people who lack stability are crushed under trials. And I've said this before and I'll say it again. Trials don't produce character, church. They reveal it. They reveal it. Tough times don't make people stronger. They reveal what strength they have. What is this year showing you about your walk, relationship, your trust, your endurance with Christ? Guys, I'm so tempted often this year to run from Christ to something, thinking that something will give me joy. Like a 64-count pack of toilet paper. Don't laugh, y'all did it too. Some of you bought two packs. But whatever it is, save a little bit more money. Whatever that is, man, we run to these things looking for stability instead of Jesus. It's no wonder then why we are crushed under the weight of our trials. But here's the sad reality, and I need you to understand this. I need you to hear this. And again, I want this to be sobering to some of us this morning. Unstable people never mature spiritually, because we're always running to the easiest thing. The minute you tell me something that I don't want to hear because it's going to be tough, it's going to be hard, I'm out. Right? Our relationship with God is like a spiritual buffet. Right? We pick and choose what we want from Jesus. As long as we don't get heartburn. But that's not how we grow. My grandson, I love him to death. But my daughter and I were talking this week, I think it was like Monday or Tuesday, and she's like, Dad, Carter's becoming a very picky eater. Really? Like I said, before Carter would eat anything, like he just, everything went in his mouth. And now, he's reduced his whole menu to ranch dressing. Like he will suck the ranch off of something and then leave that there. Just ranch and candy. Hey, I'm just saying. Right? But some of us, we do that spiritually. We don't dine on the full power and grace of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We pick and choose these things, thinking that we're getting spiritually satisfied, and we're starving to death. We're never growing. Now, I know if we allow Carter to continue to only eat ranch dressing, he's not going to develop physically as he needs to grow into a young boy and young man and into a fully developed man. We need to say, no, Carter, you got to have some broccoli, you got to have some meat, got to have some, you know, all these things. If you're vegetarian, sorry about that, but I'm just saying, like, we got to have some elk in your diet. Or else he'll be malnourished. But the same is true spiritually. We can't pick and choose and run from this hardship or this trial or this situation and expect to grow in Christ. We got to stand firm. Because that's what mature people do, right? Kids do what they want when they want. I don't feel like doing this, right? That's what our kids tell us, right? But we know as adults, there's things that we do all the time that we don't feel like doing. But we do it. Because we know what's beneficial. And again, we're trying to contribute, not just be a consumer. Well, Paul sees that. Paul sees that. And it's with that in mind, as we pick back up in chapter 4, verse 1, as we've jumped all over the Bible, that we talk about this whole idea. That's the big idea that we're going to be walking through, is this whole idea of steadfastness or standing firm. And notice, Paul implicitly gives us some things. He'll give us implicitly and explicitly some things that we should stand firm in, that we should never, ever move from. It's what are signs of a mature believer and a healthy church. And notice how he says this in verse 1. Oh, I got to get back to Philippians. Therefore, my brothers. Now, stop right there. Stop right there. Remember, okay, whenever we see a therefore, we look to see what it's. Now, again, in this case, as in so many cases, Paul is pointing us back to what he's just said in chapter 3, right? Therefore, because what? Because of the fact that we are not political orphans. We are not politically homeless. We have a citizenship in heaven. Remember, this is the word. Citizenship is the word we get our English word, political. Because our citizenship in heaven, because Christ's return is imminent, because of all this is true, and notice how he even closes off in chapter 3 there, in verse 21, who, because our bodies will be transformed to be like his glorious body, that's our future, by the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself. Therefore, brothers, and then he throws this in before he says, stand firm. And I think there's something here. He says, whom I love and long for. And then he says, my joy and crown. Then he says, stand firm thus in the Lord. And then he finishes it by saying, my beloved. Here's one thing that you and I as Christians in this time right now, where there's so much hatred and vitriol and just all this stuff going on, we should stand firm in our love. Now, Paul knew that this church was not the perfect church. We've already seen him already addressing some issues and some problems throughout the book of Philippians. He's about to address one in verse 2. But throughout the book of Philippians, he's encouraging and addressing this whole idea of unity and division and all these things that are happening to abound and work. Like they may have been slowing up, all these things. But that doesn't change his feelings for this church. He loves them dearly. He cares for these people in this church. He doesn't view this as an organization. He views this as a family that he misses, that he hasn't seen for quite literally probably now about 5 years. If timing is right, if my math is correct. He says, I long for you. But notice how he says. He says, verse 1 there, whom I love and long for. Whom I love and long for. We must remain steadfast. We must stand firm in our love. And here's for the simple reason, guys, and I'm not trying to be cliche. Love, according to God's standard, is more powerful than hate. Love is more powerful than anything. God's love. It's God's love that has brought the dead, you and I, to life. It's love that's raised the dead, made the blind see, made the lepers cleansed. It's love that has restored families and brought peace. James admonishes us that we're in the midst of conflict, that we should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to wrath. Why? Because the wrath of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Do you hear that? Your anger is going to make anyone more holy. Think about that next time you get on Facebook and you're just going to unload on somebody. Well, I'm going to give you the what for right now. Has that ever worked for any of you? Has anyone ever, like, I'm serious. Like, has anyone said, like, you've just unloaded on them and they go, I repent. I want to follow Jesus. Anybody? Yeah, me either. Why do I do it? I get so... Man, we must make steadfast in our love. In our love. I love this. We must be tenderhearted towards one another, showing love and deference for one another. This is what is needed in every church, particularly now. That we love one another. It's important. And I love that he says this in verse 1. He says, therefore, my brothers whom I love and long for. He even calls them beloved. Like, what is he saying? I love you. You're loved by God. You're loved by me. He takes that opportunity again. Even though he said this before, he says it again. And here's the important thing, guys, that I think we all can understand. I don't think any of us can hear I love you too much. Now, I just want you to know, again, on behalf of your pastors, on behalf of the leadership of Blaze, we love you so much. We pray for you all the time. We are constantly looking for ways to better serve you and equip you and release you for ministry. But you're loved. That's why we offer, that's why Vince says, man, if you need anything, call us. Leave a message, we'll be there. Because we care. And we should be doing that one for another. It's so important that we never move from the position and power that is offered through the love of Jesus Christ. It's important. And here's why. Because according to Jesus, this is the mark of a true believer. Right? Remember when we said in the book of John? He says, by this the world will know that you are my disciples. How? By the theology you've learned. No. By the love that you have one for another. It's by love. Why? Because love is the fruit of what theology you know. Love is the fruit of holiness. Love is the fruit of obedience. It's the fruit of these things. How holy you are will be revealed in how much you love. And that's why it's so frustrating, because so many of us have this incorrect view of God in the Old Testament, that he's mean and he's angry and he's wanting to get after people. But here's the reality. If we truly know God for who he is, he's holy, right? The angels fly before him day and night forever, continually crying out, holy, holy, holy. But what you see throughout the whole of Scripture is that God is love. And it's worked out throughout all his creation. And he spent all of time literally displaying that love to us through the person and work of Jesus Christ. We too are called as his disciples to live lives of love. And here's an important thing, as Jesus said this, it's important that we get this, guys. It's important that you hear this, because we've heard this scripture, we've quoted this scripture, right? The world will know you are my disciples by the love that you have for one another, or one for another, however your translation says it. Highlight that part of there. One another. The one another describes where the love starts. Where does it start? Here. The one others are you and I. The one another start in the church, the family of God. If the world can't see the family of God getting together and loving one another, why would they want to join? And for the most part, we've just displayed this dysfunctional family because we lack love. And we see this now worked out. Look at verse 2. Like there's so much more we can go in verse 1, but I'll leave that for you guys to study on your own this week. But let's move on, because we're running out of time. He says, I entreat Ouida, and I entreat Syntyche to agree in the Lord. Yes, I ask you also, true companion, help these women who have labored side by side with me in the gospel together with Clement and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are written in the book of life. What's going on here? Right? So, man, he's saying love one another, and here's the deal. If we love one another, we're going to live in unity. So what Paul's addressing here is there's a disagreement that has arisen between two prominent women in the Philippian church. And what's more than likely happened is that sides are being taken. There's part of the church that's standing behind Ouida, and there's part of the church that's standing behind Syntyche. Now, real quick, if you guys are still planning on having children, there's a couple of biblical names for you. Right? Well, what's your daughter's name? Syntyche. Anyway, I'm just saying, just throwing it out there. But anyway, so you have these two women who are now at odds with one another, and because of their disagreement, it is now affecting the entire church, so much so that Paul has to address it. What was going on? We don't know. We don't know what the disagreement was over. We do know it was to the level that Paul had to address it. We can speculate on all what it was, but we don't know. But here's what we do know. I think it's important that we understand that I think it was the Holy Spirit that prevented Paul from addressing what was going on, because we see in other portions of Scripture and other letters where Paul addresses specifically what's going on. Right, Paul in 1 Corinthians, it's actually reported that a son's sleeping with his dad's wife. Like, he lays it out there for all time immemorial. Can you imagine being that guy? Especially if he got saved and he's in heaven. Oh, you're that guy? I read about you. Right? It's like, wow. Like, right? But I think, again, there's a point being made even by the Holy Spirit, because in the end, it doesn't matter. I bet you back then there was some super important stuff. But can you imagine these two women? This is the only time they're literally, their names are recorded in all of Scripture, and this is what they're known for. Think about that for 1 second in the time that we live in. Think about that for 1 second. If in 100 years from now your grandkids are reading your tweets, your emails, your pictures, like, because it's all saved online, right? You think it goes away when you hit delete? Go ask Joe Biden Jr. about that. I'm just saying. I said it. I went there. I don't care. It's all there. Go study it for yourself. But in 100 years, what will your great-grandkids think about you? Like, this is what you're known for. And you're like, oh, man, like, I don't want to be known for this. This is ridiculous. In 100 years, this is not going to matter. Paul says, man, a mature church, mature believers, churches that have not moved from the gospel are committed to unity. Now, hear me clearly on this. We're talking about unity, not uniformity. Right? Paul has already encouraged the Philippian church to be of the same mind in Christ. Right? On the essentials, we have to agree. On the non-essentials, we can show love. Hey, you're voting one way, this guy's voting the other. In the end, does it matter? No. We should show love one to another. But on the essentials, no, we got to agree. One God, three persons. Salvation is by grace through faith in Christ. Essential stuff. But man, we should show love in all things. We should be united, not uniform. We don't have to all think the same, act the same, dress the same, even though me and Vince do. Wish you guys would get on board. But you see what I'm saying? He's calling for unity. Mature churches who are steadfast, immovable in the gospel say, we're going to keep the main thing the main thing. And we're going to let everything else, let God sort that out. And that's how we should be. And notice what he says here. Again, here's the other thing that we should stand firm in, that we should not be moved from. Verse 4, rejoice. And I have so much more we could say in verse 3. I'll let you guys study that on your own. But again, notice what he says here. Rejoice in the Lord when? Always. Don't move from the position of joy that you have. And again, I say rejoice. Rejoice. Mature Christians in the midst of any circumstance can rejoice knowing that they are not orphaned. They have a home. They have a king. His rule is certain as well as his return. So we can rejoice. Again, guys, it's important. Not just in that the Dodgers might win the World Series. Please, Lord Jesus. We rejoice in the Lord. What do you have reason to rejoice in the Lord about today? Where have you stopped rejoicing in the Lord? And thus, you've moved from a stable position that God has for you in the midst of the fiery furnace to a position of instability, which has brought about doubt, despair, discouragement, and even anger. Paul says rejoice. Not just in anything, but rejoice in the Lord. And then he says this, let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Different translation, you might have the word gentleness. Same thing. We are humble people. We shouldn't move from that. We follow the person and work of our Lord Jesus Christ. Notice what he says here as he finishes up verse 5. He says, the Lord is at hand. Now highlight that, underline that. Because when you hear that, tell me if you think this. When you hear Paul say that, do you think what he's basically getting at is that the Lord's coming? The Lord's at hand, right? The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Right? We've seen this throughout the Gospels, right? It's this idea of coming or imminence. And it can mean that. But again, wrapped up in this word is also presence. Is also presence. And so when he's saying, let your gentleness or your reasonableness be known to everyone, why? Because the Lord is in our midst. He's not only coming, he's here. He's here. We've got to stop, again, it's not only about the by and by. We're not looking for an escape. God's presence is here in us. As a matter of fact, Paul writes to the Thessalonian church that which restrains the Holy Spirit that is within us, that it'll be this way until that is taken out of the way. Then the lawless one will be revealed. Then literally all hell will break loose on the earth. But God is present right now in our midst, and so we should live that way. You know how it is with kids, right? This last week, man, we've just been having an amazing, amazing spiritual journey at our house. Man, my kids just love Jesus. They do. They really do. But just like every other kid, they fall short. And this week, Amarisa and Isaiah, call them out by name, they've been bickering and fighting like back and forth all week. And it's funny because they'll be like, and I know how it's going to go, Amarisa. And they're just going back and forth. But then we walk in the room, they're like, right? Then we go back out. You can hear them. It's like, hey, we can hear you. Our house is only 1,000 square feet. Like, I don't know what you're thinking. Like, right? And that's what we think. That's what often how we live our lives, right? We think God's in heaven somewhere far away, right? So we're just treating people horribly and acting horribly, right? But then we come to church, we're like, praise God, brother. No. God's with us. If the Holy Spirit indwells you, he goes everywhere you go. He sees everything you see. He hears everything you say. We should live in light of that. That not only is the Lord coming, he's here now. And so I close with these questions because we're over on time. Have you moved from a place of stability to a place of instability? There's times I have. Right, this whole pandemic, this whole quarantine stuff, it wears on you. And I wish I could look you guys all in the eye and say, man, every day I'm in the scriptures 4, 5, 6 hours a day. Oh, it's just awesome. There's days I look at my Bible and it's like, I don't want to. Right? I want to go after this. I just want to watch TV all day. I just want to do this. And guess what? All these things come into my head, come into my heart, and they begin to move me from stability to instability. Because I've been feeding on all the wrong things. Spending time where I shouldn't be spending time. Watching all these things on YouTube about, well, this could be this and this could be that and blah, blah, blah. And all before you know it, it's like, what's going on? Right here. The joy of the Lord is my strength. I am a disciple taught of the Lord. Obedient to his word, and great is my peace and undisturbed composure. Paul's going to talk about now anxiety next week. Right, that's what instability leads to. He's going to say, do not be anxious, verse 6, for anything. We'll get into what anything means. You guys maybe do some homework on that. Tell me what you think it means. But here's the deal. Have you moved from a place during this time of stability in Christ to instability? And you've blamed it on circumstances. Well, I lost my job. Well, this is happening. These people are getting sick around me. Oh, and so you've moved from this place of God has me to a place of fear. And now your hope is not in Christ, but more in a vaccine or a mask or whatever it is, or a president. God forbid that you're putting your hope in who gets elected in 2 weeks. God forbid. That your hope is in that Donald Trump gets reelected or that Joe Biden gets elected. Because I'm telling you right now, that's a horrible place to put your hope. Our hope's in Christ. He is the solid rock. Everything else the Bible tells us is sinking sand. For those of you that have remained faithful and stayed stable, continue. And as you do that, look around you. And encourage others likewise, just as Paul does to the Philippian church. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word.
sing this together. I was lost. I was lost in sin, held captive by my fear, till your mercy showed. Your hand was reaching near. My God, you came and made a way for me. You made a way for me. Lost in sin, held captive by my fear, till your mercy showed. Your hand was reaching near. My God, you came and made a way for me. You made a way for me. My Jesus, gracious Redeemer and friend, there's nothing like your love without end. My hope was purchased by the blood of the Lamb. My Jesus, Redeemer. Whoa. Defeated death. You defeated death. You trampled over sin. You're the risen King. You're coming back again. Oh God, you came and made a way for us. You made a way for us. Jesus, gracious Redeemer and friend, there's nothing like your love without end. My hope was purchased by the blood of the Lamb. My Jesus, Redeemer. Whoa. Free. No guilt, no shame, no curse, no chains, new life you gave, Redeemer. No guilt, no shame, no curse, no chains, new life you gave. Father, thank you for the freedom in Christ. Let's sing this one more time. No guilt, no shame. No guilt, no shame, no curse, no chains, new life you gave. Redeemer, my debt is paid, my soul now saved. Oh God, you gave.
when Paul says this, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Lord, may we never, ever move from the steadfastness of the reality of what you did 2,000 years ago on Calvary's cross. May this shape everything about us. In the same manner, also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Before you take this, I want you to remember something. I want this to anchor your soul, that what this represents is Christ's blood spilled in atonement for your sins. All of them. I'm not talking about all of them that you've committed up until this moment. I'm talking every single sin that you have committed and will ever commit have been washed away by the blood of Jesus. Let that truth anchor your soul. May it make you steadfast, and it will be that you are forgiven in Christ Jesus. Live that way. In Jesus' name. Paul says, "For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's worship.
Let's continue to worship our great King and Savior, Jesus Christ. Sing with me. I cast
my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone.
Oh, praise.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God. And on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven night, and I
will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Father, we thank you that through Jesus Christ we are made free by the breaking of his body and the shedding of his blood. The curse of sin and shame is broken. Father, I pray that that will not only give us a security of who we are right now, but it will give us a security of who we are in Christ and glory with you. Father, I pray for the souls that have been marred by sin and death in this room, asking you, God, to reveal how deep your love was for us when Jesus' blood came over us from that cross, redeeming us from sin once and for all. Let's sing this together. Oh, praise. There is nothing now that can separate us from your great love. But what that also means is that we can no longer be separated from each other that are in Christ. We are united with you. Thank you, Jesus, for your atoning death and your resurrection. Let's sing this song together as we praise the King of Kings.
From heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes, to fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt.
Praise the Father.
Praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one, God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings.
To reveal the kingdom the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross, for even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus for our sake you died.
Praise the Father.
Spirit, three in one, God. stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs.
Jesus. Jude writes this, and may it sink into your souls. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and he be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you guys. Go in peace.
Faith, I never